بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
I am your professor of ophthalmology and head of eye department, Brigadier Abdul Majid Malik. A very warm welcome to you after the summer vacations. Hopefully you have enjoyed the vacations. Not only that, you must have done a lot of prayers for Ramzan Mubarak, for the country, for the disease, to get rid of disease corona, for your family members, friends, and for yourself, and for all of the Muslims and other human beings of the world. You must have enjoyed the Eid al-Fitr with your family and friends. I am sure you must have spared some time to review the various subjects of your fourth year MBBS, particularly ophthalmology, that has been taught to you by various teachers during your class lectures as well as rotation in the department. Today is the first lecture after the vacation is over, and as I had completed diseases of the eyelids, today we are going to start lacrimal apparatus and its disorders. So to start the diseases, before that we should have a brief review of basics, that is anatomy and physiology of the gland and its drainage system. Primarily, the lacrimal system consists of three portions: a secretory portion, a spreading portion, and a drainage system. The lacrimal fluid or tears are secreted by lacrimal glands itself, the main lacrimal gland, accessory lacrimal glands, conjunctival glands, that is goblet cells, and glands of Zeiss and Mohl, and tarsal or meibomian glands present in the eyelids. Spreading system consists of our normal closing and opening of the eyelids, our healthy blink reflex, that is we blink average 5 to 6 seconds normally, and third is a normal and healthy tear film. We will discuss it in detail later. Drainage system consists of puncta, canaliculi, lacrimal sac, and the lacrimal duct, as you see here in this diagram. Now, what is the main lacrimal gland and what are accessory lacrimal glands? Main lacrimal gland is an almond shaped gland located in the anterior and lateral portion of the orbit, superior lateral to the eyeball. It is a acinar gland, seroacinar gland, that pours its secretion through 10 to 12 ducts into the superior conjunctival fornix. This gland is mainly activated under reflex conditions and for flushing of the eye when a lot of tears are required for any reason in the eyeball. Under basal secretion, the other glands, they are known as accessory glands, as shown in lower diagram. They are responsible for most of the basic secretion. These are two glands of Krauss and glands of Wolfram. They are located subconjunctivally. As you see in the picture, glands of Krauss are located at the outer margin of the fornices, whereas glands of Wolfram are located at the outer margin of the tarsal plate under the conjunctiva. They secrete their secretion through fine ducts into the conjunctival sac around the clock, and they keep the eyes wet. They are the mainly responsible glands for production and maintenance of our basic tear secretion. There are about 20 in the upper eyelids and 8 in the lower eyelids. So you remember, under basic conditions, the tear secretion is produced primarily by the accessory lacrimal glands, whereas under stress, emotional condition, or whenever there is some trauma or there is reflex vomiting from the eye due to any reason, then main lacrimal gland comes into action and there is reflex vomiting and lot of fluid produced to wash away all the irritants from the eye. So reflex secretion is being produced by main lacrimal gland and basic secretion is produced mainly by glands of Krauss and Wolfram, that is accessory lacrimal glands. Remember, you are not to forget it. Nerve supply of the gland. Sensory nerve supply is through the lacrimal branch of ophthalmic nerve, sympathetic through carotid process, and very important is the secretomotor nerve supply, which is supplied by the facial nerve. It originates in the superior salivary nucleus of the pons, then through nervous intimatus branch of the facial nerve, through superficial petrosal nerve and nerve pterygoid canal, traversing through the pterygopalatine canal, ganglion, fossa, and ultimately zygomatic nerve, and joins the lacrimal nerve in the orbit and ultimately splice lacrimal glands. Whenever there is irritation in the eye or emotional stress or whatever situation that irritates the superior salivary nucleus, the nucleus sends its secretomotor impulses. They are passed through this chain of nervous system ultimately to the lacrimal gland, cause the contraction of its smooth muscles, and lot of copious secretion of the gland is poured into the superior cantilever fornix and to wash away all the irritants. Now brief anatomy of the Denny system. Denny system consists of structures like punctata, as you see here. They are present in the medial portion of the eyelid margin, one in upper, one in the lower. They are surrounded by a sphere known as lacrimal papilla. Then there is small hole, lacrimal punctum. So gland is only around 10 millimeter. Sorry, the lacrimal punctum opened into lacrimal canaliculus. Lacrimal canaliculus is 10 millimeter long. 2 millimeter first portion of it is vertical, as seen in the diagram, lower as well as upper. 2 millimeter first is vertical, then the 8 millimeter horizontal. Then these two canaliculi joins medially to form common canaliculus that opens into the lacrimal sac. Lacrimal sac is present in the middle portion of the anterior part of the orbit over the lacrimal bone. It is surrounded by a fascia and then surrounded by an extension of the orbicularis muscle known as Horner muscle that surrounds the lacrimal sac, and that muscle is attached externally to the fascia of the lacrimal bone. I will tell its importance soon in the Denny system. Then this lacrimal sac that is around 10 millimeter long opens into another lacrimal duct, which is 12 to 18 millimeter, 12 millimeter bony, and 6 millimeter is the cartilaginous portion, and this opens into the inferior meatus of the nose just below the inferior turbinate, where it is guarded by a valve known as valve of Hessner. That valve is responsible for control of the tear flow. It does not let nasal secretions come back or regurgitate into the lacrimal sac, but allows only lacrimal secretion to pass through it to the nasal cavity. That is only one way valve. So this is the lacrimal drainage system. Next slide, slide number 7. Here you see, it is page number 7, slide number 6. You are seeing the lacrimal fluid or secretion produced by the gland pass into the eye, then passing along the conjunctiva and cornea to punctae, and through canaliculi it reaches sac, lacrimal sac, and through duct it reaches the inferior meatus of the nose, just below the inferior turbinate, as I had told earlier. Now, what is the mechanism of drainage? Why tears are drained medially and to the lacrimal sac, and they don't misdirect themselves in any other direction? What happens? That our normal blinking system keeps on pushing the lacrimal fluid or tears being produced from lateral to middle direction. They pass along the lower eyelid margin between the lower lid and the conjunctiva as a sort of a 2 millimeter vertically 2 millimeter semi-convex line of tear flow or tear meniscus that keeps flowing medially up to the punctae, where from it is absorbed or sucked into the punctae by capillary action. See the next diagram, next slide. Once the tears are accumulated on the medial portion of the conjunctival sac, this is known as conjunctival lake or lacus lacrimalis, tear lake or lacus lacrimalis. At this time, the lacrimal sac itself is collapsed, and as we blink, as seen in the central portion of this diagram, as the eye closes while blinking, the muscle around the lacrimal sac contracts outwards and dilates the lacrimal sac, which develops negative pressure, and it sucks the tears from lacus lacrimalis through punctae and canaliculi and gets filled. And as soon as we open our eye, as in the outermost right diagram C, while opening, the muscle relaxes, muscle around the lacrimal sac, that is horn muscle, relaxes, and natural recoil of the lacrimal sac tissue makes it contract, and the tears are pushed down into the nasal cavity through the nasal lacrimal duct. This is the normal lacrimal drainage system. In elderly people, this muscle becomes weak, horn muscle becomes weak, and despite normal drainage channels, the tear flow is obstructed and they suffer from watering from the eye, that is epiphora. That is due to weakness of this muscle. This can affect healthy young people as well. When they develop facial nerve paralysis, and as a result of that, this portion of the orbicularis muscle also gets paralyzed, and patients suffer from epiphora. Next slide, slide number 10. Now, secretions coming from the lacrimal gland and accessory lacrimal glands, they are produced in the amount as mentioned here, 0.5 to 1.5 gram per 16 waking hours. While we are asleep, they generally don't secrete tears. And all the glands, that is lacrimal glands, goblet cells, and glands in the eyelids, they constitute the tear film, very important tear film that is covering our cornea and conjunctiva. Now look at the diagram here. Tear film has three portions: an outer portion that is in contact with atmosphere. This consists of lipid. It is 0.01 micrometer, very thin layer that coats the tear film, secreted by meibomian glands and glands of Zeiss. So it is lipid in nature. It prevents evaporation and stabilizes the tear film. The second, the blue color, is the thickest layer, that is 7 micrometer thickest. This is almost more than 98% of the total tear film. It is produced mainly by accessory lacrimal glands and to some extent by main lacrimal gland. And it is the major portion of the tear film. I will discuss this function later. The deeper most layer, as shown brown in this diagram, that is mucinous layer, 0.02 to 0.05 micrometer thick. It is thicker than lipid layer but much thinner than aqueous layer. It sticks internally to the epithelium of the cornea and neutralizes its irregularities, and superficially it sticks to the aqueous layer of the tear film and does not permit its wasting or loss. It keeps and holds it along with the corneal epithelium. So you see, cornea is not directly in contact with atmosphere. It is through this tear film that it is in contact with atmosphere indirectly. Now see the next page, functions of the tear film. As you look at the tear film, lipid layer stabilizes the tear film by retarding the evaporation. Like you spill oil over water, glass, all the day you will see there is no evaporation because oil does not prevents evaporation of the water. So is the function of lipid layer in the tear film. It keeps a thin layer of the lipid and it retards or prevents evaporation of the aqueous from the tear film. Secondly, it is a lubricant. It makes it comfortable to blink and spread the tear film all around the conjunctival and corneal epithelium. In its deficiency, we feel raw and we feel itching and foreign body sensation while we blink. So it has two functions. The other layer is the aqueous layer, that is the main layer of the tear produced by lacrimal glands, accessory as well as main. Major function is to flush away the foreign bodies that really fall in the eye and keep on falling when we are walking, especially without the glasses, sunglasses, etc. Secondly, it provides a wet surface to the cornea and conjunctiva and provides nutrition to the cornea. Particularly important is the 100% oxygen supply of the cornea is through air. That is the only organ in the body that receives its oxygen supply through air directly, and that oxygen is dissolved into the tear film and only then it is supplied to the cornea. If there is any damage to the tear film, this oxygen supply suffers and cornea will become hazy. Moreover, this tear film is the sole supply of water to the corneal epithelium. Deeper structures get their water supply from aqueous humor as well. Another important function of the aqueous layer is presence of bactericidal lysozymes and betalysine that prevents microbial infection. So it has a role in the defense of the cornea against infections. So these are the four functions as mentioned here. Now the third and deepest most layer, the mucinous layer, which was shown brown, that is 0.02 to 0.05 micrometer. It coats the superficial epithelium of the cornea as I told, and keeps that smooth and uniform the irregularities of the corneal surface. Secondly, it converts hydrophobic surface of the cornea into hydrophilic surface, and that is why it holds the aqueous layer of the tear film along the cornea. In case of goblet cell problems or diseases, this layer becomes thin and weak and aqueous layer cannot be held on the cornea and eye becomes dry. So these are the functions of the three layers. Now, how the patient presents? The patient having disease of the lacrimal glands, they present either in two ways, that is either wet eye or dry eye. Wet eye is the one in which there is epiphora. Epiphora is watering from the eyes due to obstruction of the lacrimal drainage system, and lacrimation is excess watering from the eyes due to excessive secretion of the tears. So make the difference. Watering may be due to lacrimation once it is being produced more than normal from the lacrimal glands, and epiphora once production of the aqueous is, of this lacrimal fluid or tears is normal, but there is some compromisation of the drainage system starting from puncta canaliculi, lacrimal sac, आर नेज लैक्रिमल डक्ट एटसेट्रा. The so cause of epiphora are simple to understand, starting from its punctum, stenosis of the punctum, lower or upper, obstruction to the canaliculi, obstruction to the nasolacrimal duct, inadequate lacrimal sac pumping, as I had mentioned, in elderly people and the people who have patient paralysis. Once the orbicularis oculi muscle becomes paralyzed and its horn muscle, that dilates the sac. Once we blink, that also becomes paralyzed. So despite the normal drainage system, there is watering and the tears are not being pumped from the lacrimal sac down to the nasolacrimal duct. So this is another important cause of epiphora in elderly people and people with reduced function of the orbicularis oculi muscle. And last, in the traumatic lesions in which there is traumatic damage to the lacrimal canaliculi or nasolacrimal duct. So these are the common causes of epiphora, that is watering, excess watering due to decreased outflow or drainage of tears. Now for diagnostic purpose, we carry out certain tests like regurgitation test, I will explain later, taste test. Taste test is instill a drop of chlorpheniclone in the eye. It is bitter in taste. If after a minute or two the patient complains of bitter taste in the throat, it means the lacrimal system, drainage system is patent and chlorpheniclone drops have reached the nasal cavity and the throat. And this is a simple test that can fulfill your requirement of testing. The other and technically important test is fluorescein or dye test. I will explain it with the diagram on the next page. So come on back. Regurgitation test. First was the taste test. Second is the regurgitation test. You should push pressure on the middle side of the of eyelid between the nasal side and the inner sides of the eyelids, where they are approximating one another. Push here with your index finger or thumb, and if secretion or mucus regurgitates through the puncta into the gingival sac as seen in this diagram, it means that there is obstruction of the nasolacrimal duct and fluid is being accumulated into the lacrimal sac. In such cases, you will also see a swelling on the medial side of the eyelids. So first test was the taste test, then is the regurgitation test, and then is the Jones dye test. Very important to learn it and understand it. Actually what happens, that we assess the normal drainage system of the eye. How we do it? We instill a drop of anesthetic agent in the eye and spray anesthetic into the nasal cavity to prevent reflex secretion. We have to measure basic secretion in Jones 1 test. So once this is done, we either put a drop of fluorescein or a fluorescein strip as shown in this picture in the gingival sac. This dissolved and greenish yellow fluorescein passes through the nasolacrimal system, and that is puncta, canaliculi, sac and duct, and it reaches the nose. We have already placed a cotton placket in the nasal cavity. So if this cotton placket, as shown in this picture here, it becomes brown or green, it means the nasolacrimal drainage system is patent and there is no obstruction anywhere. And see in the other diagram, figure 14, here the same process is done, but after a time of 2 to 3 minutes, you didn't see any coloration of the cotton placket that was placed in the nasal cavity. Why? Because there is obstruction. If there is obstruction anywhere, but that is in the canaliculi, in the nasolacrimal duct or whatever, this cotton placket will not turn orange, yellow or green due to dye. So Here the Jones dye test is negative. In first case, the Jones test dye was positive once the cotton patch got stained, and here in this one, second one, it is negative. So once it is negative, then we carry out Jones 2 or secondary Jones test as shown in the right second figure. In first diagram, again it is repetition, that is we had placed the strip of fluorescein and we found the cotton patch was not turned yellow or green, so it was the dye was not reaching there. So second test is done, we push fluid or saline through a syringe from the lacrimal canaliculi as seen here in the diagram Jones 2. It pushes the fluid if present in this lacrimal sac, and the fluid is pushed down to the nasal cavity and cotton patch gets or turns green or orange color. If it happens so, that indicates there is lacrimal pump failure. I mean the fluid was drained from the punctal canaliculi into the lacrimal sac, was persisting there, but due to weakness of the muscle or muscle that was not contracting properly, or due to very narrow nasal lacrimal duct, it was not reaching the nasal cavity. So in Jones 2, if you push saline through it and if the cotton patch gets colored, it means that canaliculi are patent, duct is also okay. There is either lacrimal pump failure or narrowing of the nasal lacrimal duct due to some reason. However, if you push saline through syringe as shown in the lower portion of this diagram, still there is no wetting or no dye staining the cotton patch in the nasal cavity. It means that obstruction is before the lacrimal sac, I mean in the canaliculi themselves, and dye had not reached the lacrimal sac because of that. So there will be that will indicate narrowing of the canaliculi. In this case, by pushing it, the cotton patch in the nasal cavity will become wet but not stained, because there was no stain in the lacrimal sac and only saline is going, and it causes wetting of the patch. So this is way you understand the dye test Jones 1 and Jones 2. Next, simple probing of the drainage system to assess the site of obstruction. In the left picture, you see this lacrimal probe having a handle in the center and blunt ended probe on two sides. You push the probe through inferior or superior punctum into the lacrimal canaliculus, which passes through the common canaliculus and passes through the lacrimal sac and touches the medial wall of the sac, that is lacrimal bone. In such cases, we will feel a hard stop. Hard stop means that all the lacrimal canaliculi and sac are patent, so it is reaching the lacrimal bone. And if the patient still had epiphora, it means site of obstruction is below the lacrimal sac, that is in the lacrimal duct. Whereas if it is soft, I will show it later, as in this diagram. See the next diagram. Next diagram, left side, soft stop. Here you see the lacrimal canalicular tissue as well as lacrimal sac is pushed in front of this canaliculus. We are using in this picture the cannula of the syringe. So cannula, whatever we use, whether cannula or the lacrimal probe, it pushes against the soft tissue and then soft tissue pushes against the lacrimal bone. So it is, you feel like a soft stop, jaise ki na kisi nerve ke against aap daba rahe ho. Agar aisa hai, to there is obstruction in the lacrimal canaliculi or lacrimal sac itself and not in the nasal lacrimal duct. While in other picture, the right one, you see the lacrimal probe is directly touching to the medial wall of the lacrimal sac, that is lacrimal bone. And so there is no obstruction till this place. So if there is epiphora, obstruction is in the lower portion, that is in the nasolacrimal duct. So this is hard stop. So simply to learn, if you do probing of the lacrimal drainage system, if there is soft stop, means obstruction in the lacrimal canaliculi or sac. If there is hard stop, it means there is obstruction in the nasolacrimal duct or pump failure. Other tests that we can carry out, go back to page number 14 or slide number 13. The next test after fluorescein dyed or zone test are and probing is dacryocystography. We instill a dye in the conjunctival sac and see radial photographs, and wherever dye is blocked, the X-rays will show no dye passing beyond that, and then we can localize the site of obstruction, just like IVU. And radiocystography is technician 99 is introduced into the conjunctival sac to monitor the accuracy drainage system. And radioactivity is measured from nasal cavity with the gamma camera. This is practically not done. So next is the page number 16. Sorry, slide number 16 and page number 19. What is lacrimation? As I had told, lacrimation is excessive vomiting from the eye due to excess production of tears from the lacrimal gland. It may be caused by reflex reasons like lesion of the eyelids, like trichiasis, entropion and ectropion, where there is rubbing of the conjunctiva and cornea and there is reflex vomiting, inflammations like keratitis and conjunctivitis, and exposure keratopathy as in facial paralysis and Graves' disease, where eyelids are not properly closed, approximated, and irritation of the cornea produces reflex watering. The other one is central causes. Emotional stress. A person gets failed in the exam or some near relative dies. So psychological, emotional stimuli, they produce reflex watering, and that is due to central causes, due to activation of the superior salivary nucleus by our hypothalamic system. A term known as crocodile tear syndrome is interesting but very rare. It happens in some people while they eat or eat anything, at the same time water starts from their eyes. It is very interesting and embarrassing for the patient. It is due to the incoherent interaction or attachments between fibers of the gland, neural fibers supplying the pharynx, that is gasopharyngeal nerve, and those supplying the lacrimal glands. Very interesting. Oh, it happens once this nerve or pterygoid canal passes into the pterygoid palatine fossa. Some fibers go to the lacrimal gland through lacrimal nerve, and some fiber pass from the through the nasal branches into the nasal cavity and in the pharynx, and this causes interesting syndrome of crocodile tear syndrome while we are eating food. Very interesting and very embarrassing for the patient. So that is all about the basics and some thing related to the wet eye. So the job of today is done. You must go home, read it thoroughly from your books, and I will send you a questionnaire sort of thing, that is homework actually. You will complete it and send to the telephone number of my PA, which I will share with you on your class group. Probably you already know it. Mr. Muhammad Umar is my PA, whom you have already been sending this assignment. So today's homework or assignment will be on this portion of the lacrimal system, and you will complete it and send it preferably before the start of your next lecture, that is 12 midday. Thank you very much. अब इसको मैं